Hello, you're watching Sideline. On the occasion of Australia Day celebrated on January 26th, we've invited Australian Ambassador to Mongolia, His Excellency Dave Vosin, to discuss the significance of Australia Day and the Mongolian and Australian relations. So, hello, Mr. Vosin. Thank you for accepting our invitation and happy Australia Day.
Thank you very much. It's a great pleasure to be on your show. Thank you.
Okay. So first question is about Australia Day. So January 26th is the national holiday for Australians, and which celebrates the 1788 arrival of Captain Arthur Phillip on Australian soil. And can you tell us about how this day is celebrated today, and also more history behind this day?
Yeah, thank you for the question. I think it's a very significant day in modern Australian history. Clearly the events of 1788 are very different to how modern Australia celebrates Australia Day. But the arrival of the First Fleet, a set of ships sailing from Britain to establish a colony in what is now modern Australia, was a very significant event. It was significant for those who sought to establish a colony, but for others it also represented significant loss, especially for those, our Indigenous people, who had called that land home for over 60,000 years. So I think that day is still significant in Australia's history, but today it's a more of an opportunity for us to reflect on our history, to show respect, particularly for our Indigenous people, but also reflect and respect in what is now a very multicultural Australian society. But also it's a real opportunity to celebrate, and I think there's nothing better than celebrating what we have, celebrating our values, celebrating our freedoms. I think it's also a really important day now for Australians to reaffirm what they want to see in a modern Australia. Mm-hmm. We see a lot of citizenship ceremonies celebrated on Australia Day, so welcoming new Australians to our country, giving them a chance to express their views and their visions for a modern Australia. If I can just for a minute reflect on our national anthem. Mm-hmm. Our national anthem was written over 200 years ago, and there's been a number of changes to our national anthem over that time. A lot of the original language was about boys and sons. It was quite focused on the men. A lot of the changes, some of the changes that have occurred have changed some of that language to reflect all Australian citizens, not just our men. We also made a change to our national anthem this January. So a most recent change to our national anthem.
Okay.
Well, we used to, the verse in, the sentence in the national anthem said that we are young and free. Mm-hmm. We've now changed that to we are one and free. So I think that's a real reflection of Australia's Indigenous history, our Indigenous people, and a connection between our people rather than focusing on those events from 1788. So, you know, I think for Australians, our ability to change and adapt, particularly change our national anthem, is a reflection of how we show respect to those people who have been before us, but also talk about the vision that we want for a future Australia.
Okay, thank you very much. So now I want to talk about the relations between our two countries. Mm-hmm. So next year will mark the 50th anniversary of the diplomatic relations established between Mongolia and Australia. Mm-hmm. So what kind of important events have happened in the past 49 years, would you say, that have shaped our relations today?
Yeah, thank you. 50 years is significant, and I look back to what might have happened in 1972 and where both our countries were. Many of us weren't born in 1972. Many of your viewers won't have been born in 1972. But we look back at the state of both our economies, We were both agricultural, fundamentally agricultural economies. And I think over the last 50 years, we've seen that diversification in our economies, particularly led by very strong mining sectors. And I think the wealth that has been generated, the improvement to living standards that we've seen in both our countries, has really been a function of strong economic growth, but also making sure that we're respecting our environments, being careful of all the investments that we've made in those really important sectors. Mm-hmm. I think the most significant event over those 50 years, though, is Mongolia's path to democracy. We obviously support Mongolia's striving for democracy. The strength of those institutions that underpin democracies, whether it's the judiciary, media, NGOs, organisations like yours that hold governments to account, those accountability functions that underpin democracies are so important. So I think over the 50 years, particularly the last 30 years, watching how Mongolia has sought to give every citizen access to education, access to health, holding everyone accountable before the law, mm-hmm. Those freedoms that we enjoy as democracies are so important to Australians, mm-hmm. and we know they're so important to Mongolians. And I think that's, you know, those events of the 90s really stick in a lot of Australians' memories as Mongolians showing great courage and great determination, mm-hmm. and great sacrifice to push for a system that we think is fundamentally important for all of the freedoms and all of the rights that we expect as humans.
Okay, thank you very much. And it's certain that our two countries' connection relations have grown stronger after the democracy. Yeah. So now I'm going to talk about the COVID-19 mm-hmm. pandemic, because for the past 1 year, like over 1 year, it has been very challenging for all the world's countries. Okay, so could you tell us what steps Australia has taken in order to step up the process of repatriating Australians living in Mongolia to get back their home, and also helping Mongolians in Australia to get back to Mongolia?
Sure, thank you. At our Australia Day event last year, we started to hear signs from the government here that strong restrictions would be put in place. So Australia Day is important for me as an Australian, but it also sticks there as that event last year where measures from the government here were starting to be introduced. Schools were being closed, and we were starting to hear about the restrictions in transport and closure of border crossings. I think the moves that the government of Mongolia introduced early was so effective because they were decisive and they were clear. There was no ambiguity, there were no exemptions. It was straight out, very clear measures. And I think the leadership, the government, and all of the citizens of Mongolia should really be congratulated. Mm-hmm. The fact that this country has managed for so long to keep COVID at bay, mm-hmm. Is a real credit. Not just to the government, but also to the people who abide by those measures.
It's been nearly 10 months without. Yeah.
It's been a long time, and I think people have felt it in a number of different ways. On the repatriation side, I think many Australians who live and work and love spending time in this country feel extremely safe here. There are many countries around the world where the Australian government has had to be more active in terms of repatriating Australians. I think the relationship that we have with the SEC, the relationship we have with MIAT, the relationship we have with MFA has meant that we've been able to assist those Australians depart and to return to Australia if they've wanted to. Mm-hmm. But again, I think for the most part, so many Australians feel so comfortable here because of the measures that have been taken. So we've supported many Australians' return, mm-hmm. but it hasn't been perhaps the priority that it's been in other countries. So I think certainly I'd commend the government for their efforts. I think the other thing that really stands out as an embassy here is just the professionalism of those businesses that are associated with Australian companies. Australian companies, particularly our mining companies, have such a strong focus on health and safety. Mm-hmm. So the responsibility for ensuring the well-being and health and safety of staff really rests with those businesses. So again, I just commend those businesses that have continued to prioritise the health and safety and sanitation of all their staff. And I think that combination between business, between government and citizens themselves has really shown Mongolia to be at the top of the list in terms of the way that governments and countries have dealt with COVID.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so the next question is about the people-to-people links between our two countries. Mm-hmm. And if we talk about one of the most impactful project is, of course, the Australia Awards Scholarship. Mm-hmm. And it's been going on also successfully. So how would you say the COVID-19 pandemic has impacted the project?
Thank you. I agree. I think the when we talk about investments, we can talk about agriculture or mining or whatever. When you make an investment in someone's education, it can't be lost. It can't be wiped away. And I think there's that priority that Mongolians place on education is so aligned with the values and the priority that Australia places on education. So I think as an investment, that Australia Awards Scholarships, the alumni program, the Mozzies, that are associated with those scholarships, but also our Women's Leadership Program, all of that work that supports Mongolian young people and future leaders is just so important. And again, as an ambassador, I'm extremely proud of those investments. Because of COVID, we haven't been able to deploy those scholars last year. We're continuing to support them. They're continuing their English language education and training. Some of them are still working, some of them are preparing for study. As soon as we're in a position to get them on the next MIRT flight to Australia, we'll do it. Mm-hmm. But I think we're realistically looking probably towards semester two in the middle of 2021. So hopefully by June, the majority of those magnificent Mongolian scholars will be able to travel to Australia. So, yeah, a short interruption. The Mongolian scholars that are already in Australia, again, not many have returned. So I think that's a reflection of how well Australia's done dealing with the COVID situation. I also think it's a function of how supportive our scholarship program is. We focus on the families, we focus on the students, but we also want to make sure they succeed. So we're putting a lot of work in to support those students when they're in country, when they're in Australia, to make sure that they've got all the support they need to continue their studies successfully.
Have you decreased the number of people who would go to, who will win the scholarship this year?
Yeah, every year, again, with every program, the number of scholarships is determined by our budget availability. There's some pressures on our budget because we need to respond to different priorities. But we're keeping the number of scholarships about the same, which is good.
Great.
The quality is amazing. I mean, the scholars that come through, their applications are just amazing, and we know when they come back the contribution they make to this country. Mm-hmm. So again, when we talk about investments, we want to maximise the number of people that can travel. Mm-hmm. But it's only one part of the work that we do here.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Yeah. So, is an ambassador representing the country that is one of the most one of the biggest investors of Mongolia? How do you see the future of our two countries' relations? And in the future, what do you think we should focus on in order to mutually benefit from this cooperation?
Yeah, that's a really important question. I think when we talk to Mongolian leaders, they reflect on Mongolia's two greatest assets, and they tell us that Mongolia's two greatest assets are its people. Mm-hmm. And its natural wealth, its natural endowment. So I think for the Australian aid program, we focus on those two areas. And so I think there's natural alignment there. I think they're the right things to be doing. We don't try and do everything in the country because we only have a limited capacity ourselves, but I think we're focusing on the right things. There's only three ways really to grow an economy: your population, your productivity, and your participation. So if we look at population, there are questions around migration, there are questions about fertility rates, there are questions about how does Mongolia increase its 3 mil population, but their choice is for Mongolia to make, not for others to make. I think Australia's assets here are really focusing on how we can increase the rate of participation. Mm-hmm. So how do we make sure that every person has the skills they need to do their jobs, whether it's tertiary skills or TVET skills, or work in the mining sector or in agriculture? How do we make sure that every Mongolian has the opportunity to participate in the economy, regardless of their gender, regardless of their sexuality, regardless of their disability? Mm-hmm. So how do we increase the participation rate to make sure that everyone's got access and can make a contribution to economic growth? And that's a big feature of Australia's work here. That's what we really focus on. I think productivity, you know, that function between inputs and outputs is the other thing that's really important for Mongolia. And I think Australia particularly can play such a positive role in terms of increasing productivity in Mongolia. So that's where we're talking about innovation and technology, when we're talking about how to make the agriculture sector more productive. How do we look at logistics? How do we look at infrastructure? So I think for Australia, if we really focus on participation and focus on productivity, they're things that will lift the mining sector, will lift the agriculture sector, and fundamentally improve, you know, with Mongolian leadership, the opportunities that are available to every Mongolian.
Mm-hmm. Can you name the specific works and projects that have been done in order to improve the participation and productivity of Mongolians by Australian side?
Yeah. So we've got our main focus in the mining sector is it's the Australia-Mongolia Extractives Program. Mm-hmm. We work very closely with civil society organisations, we work very closely with ministries, we work very closely with business to see how Australia can make a contribution to making sure Mongolia has the most competitive mining sector. So we're very interested in tax rates, we're very interested in the distribution of benefits, we're very interested in the laws and the regulations that underpin the mining sector. So it's not very sexy work, and it doesn't make for good TV, but it's really important stuff for Mongolia to have that foundation of an investment environment that can attract foreign direct investment, but can also protect and promote domestic investment. So we do a lot of work there on the mining sector in particular. On the participation side, we try and support again through the Australia Award Scholarships. Mm-hmm. We're very strong supporters of the development of the TVET sector. So how do we support those polytechnics? How do we support those trade schools to make sure that they're providing the labour for the jobs of the future? They're not providing labour for the jobs of the past. Mm-hmm. So how do we make sure that the technology, the innovation, the learning is looking 5 or 10 years forward to make sure that every Mongolian has an opportunity for a meaningful job and meaningful work, but also that it's internationally competitive. So I think they're the two main focuses of our aid program, and through the Australia Award Scholarship and through our Australia-Mongolia Extractives Program, that's really where we're supporting those ministries and those people working all across this country to give people those opportunities.
Mm, thank you very much. So our time is coming to an end, unfortunately. So what final message would you like to say to our audience?
Well, I think to all the Australians watching, Happy Australia Day, wherever you're watching. But also to our Mongolian friends and partners. There are many Mongolians living in Australia, studying, working, raising families, enjoying lamb, enjoying our wine, enjoying our beaches and our drinks, but also enjoying the freedoms that we have in Australia that we're so proud of. So, Happy Australia Day to all the Australians, and Happy New Year to all our Mongolian friends and partners too. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Thank you very much. You've watched Sightline on MNB World. On the occasion of Australia Day celebrated on January 26th, we spoke to Australian Ambassador to Mongolia, His Excellency Dave Bosin. Thank you for watching. Goodbye.